With joy, we begin our life-giving celebration in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Good evening to you all.
Good evening, Father.
And I welcome you to this celebration of our lives. We have come before God, a God of mercy, a God of love, a God who is ready and willing to forgive. If only we approach him today, the Lord says to us, inasmuch as I forgive you, inasmuch as I show you what love means, you do not have to look at me and keep quiet. You do not have to accept my blessings and keep quiet. Do the same. The Lord is calling us to forgive one another. He's calling us to a new and a better life in love. Have you failed to forgive? Are there people who have hurt you and you have them at the back of your minds? Bring them at this moment before this altar of sacrifice. Let the Lord himself take control. Let the Lord himself do the healing and let him do the forgiving so that we might too be forgiven. With this in mind, let us remember that we are sinners and in need of God's love and forgiveness. Let us remember the times we have wronged God and wronged others. Let us be sorry for them as we ask God for his pardon and peace.
Lord Jesus, your cross and resurrection signal the new beginning of peace and reconciliation. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, your comfort to those who seek forgiveness and healing. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you give us a new commandment that we love one another as you have loved us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
And may the Almighty God have mercy on us. May he forgive us our sins and bring us to life everlasting.
You alone are the Lord. You
Look upon us, O God, creator and ruler of all things, and that we may feel the working of your mercy. Grant that we may serve you with all our hearts, through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Proclamation from the book of Sirach. Wrath and anger are hateful things, yet the sinner hugs them tight. The vengeful will suffer the Lord's vengeance, for he remembers their sins in detail. Forgive your neighbor's injustice. Then, when you pray, your own sins will be forgiven. Could anyone nourish anger against another and expect healing from the Lord? Could anyone refuse mercy to another like himself? Can he seek pardon for his own sins? If one who is but flesh cherishes wrath, who will forgive his sins? Remember your last days. Set enmity aside. Remember death and decay, and cease from sin. Think of the commandments. Hate not your neighbor. Remember the Most High's covenant and overlook false. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, none of us lives for oneself, and no one dies for oneself. For if we live, we live for the Lord, And if we die, we die for the Lord. So then, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's. For this is why Christ died and came to life, that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus and asked him, Lord, if my brother sins against me, how often must I forgive? As many as seven times? Jesus answered, I say to you, not seven times, but 77 times. That is why the kingdom of heaven may be likened to a king who decided to settle accounts with his servants. When he began the accounting, a debtor was brought before him who owed him a huge amount. Since he had no way of paying it back, his master ordered him to be sold, along with his wife, his children, and all his property, in payment of the debt. At that, the servant fell down, did him homage, and said, be patient with me, and I will pay you back in full. Moved with compassion, the master of that servant let him go, and forgave him the loan. When that servant had left, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him a much smaller amount. He seized him and started to choke him, demanding, pay back what you owe. Falling to his knees, his fellow servant begged him, be patient with me and I will pay you back. But he refused. Instead, he had the fellow servant put in prison until he paid back the debt. Now when his fellow servant saw what had happened, they were deeply disturbed and went to their master and reported the whole affair. His master summoned him and said to him, you wicked servant, I forgave you your entire debt because you begged me to. Should you not have had pity on your fellow servant as I had pity on you? Then in anger, his master handed him over to the torturers until he should pay back the whole debt. So will my heavenly Father do to you unless each of you forgives your brother from your heart. The gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Good evening to you all.
Good evening, Father.
You know, one of the greatest people we hate in life is a nosy neighbor. Am I right? Dennis, am I right? A nosy neighbor. Nobody would like to have a nosy neighbor. You know? But would you like your nosy neighbor? Would you? Would you love your nosy neighbor? Imagine. Would you love your nosy neighbor? Nosing around, whatever you do, who comes and goes into your house, what you are cooking. You know, it is difficult for us to be very comfortable with those who annoy us. Am I right? Yes, it is. Pretty difficult. That what we always want is people who bring us good news, who make us feel good and happy. Am I right? But then how often do we as individuals want to do the same to others? We don't want others to hear about us. We don't want others to know what we are doing. But believe you me, deep down in you, you want to know what everybody is doing. Am I right? Yes, you want to know, but you want your own to be kept secret. And that is where problems arise in the world. For us Christians, we want this, we want that, we want that. And we think whatever thing we do is right. And that is why sometimes you see some Christians telling you, is it because of this thing I did, this small thing, that we become so much ignorant that that small thing might be big for the other, for the recipient. Do you understand? I just said a few words to her. That was what I did. I just said a few words to him. A few words. But those few words are hurting to the extent that the other feels like dying. And we do not care. Only a few words. Today, the Lord is challenging us. And he is asking us to forgive. How ready and willing are you to forgive? How much have you forgiven? The first reading, Bethsaida, Ecclesiasticus, reminds us, if we do not forgive, how can we expect God to forgive us? If we as human persons fail to forgive our neighbors, do we have the right to approach God's throne of mercy, asking him for forgiveness? No. The measure you give is the measure you get. That is what the Lord is telling us. He takes us back to the gospel. And Jesus reminds us of the two servants. Peter was so eager. You know one thing I like Peter for? Very eager to speak. Because he is a man of action. He believes in the here and now. He went to Jesus. How many times must my brother sin against me and I will forgive him? Seven times, right? So that I can count it. Just seven, I will get him. Don't worry. And the Lord looked at him and saw that in his heart is that ignorance of the word and the wisdom of God. You have to understand that in the Jewish life, the perfection of everything is worth seven. So Peter came to the Lord and he wanted to know, when my brother sins and sins and sins and offends me until when I cannot endure it, the seventh time, the perfection of all the offenses, should I give back? But then he was deflected. The Lord said no. Not seven times, but 77 times. And I bet you, by the time you write the offenses of your brothers or sisters 77 times, you would have become tired of buying exercise books. You have become tired of buying the ledger and registering their sins or their offenses against you. How ready are we as individuals to let this go? What are we carrying in our hearts as God's children? How easily do we take offense? And how ready are we to let the offenses go? Jesus speaks to us today and he says, look, two servants, one owed the master the wages of one full year. Many of us who are working here, you know, if your company owes you for a year, you can as well as retire and go and rest. Because whenever they pay you that money, you become very rich. Am I right? Yes. He owed that amount. But then he went back to the master. The master said, pay me. He said, I do not have the money. Be patient with me. Have mercy on me, and I will pay you back gradually when I make the money. The master looked at him I saw the poverty, but above all, the master was patient. In his love, he had compassion. And he said to him, okay, you no longer owe me. I cast you your debt. Just go home and have fun. In his joy, he left his master's presence. As he was rejoicing and campaigning, he saw a fellow servant who owed him just one day's pay. Just one day. He called him, come here. Where is my money? And the poor servant begged him, can you come down from me? Be patient with me. I will pay you back. I be patient with you. You are very stupid. He insulted him and took him and locked him up in jail. Impatience. Sometimes in our lives, it is the same with us. That we fail to understand that the Lord has forgiven us. Even while we were still sinners, the word of God said, Jesus came and died for sinners. He went to the cross and he died, that our sins might be forgiven. Then why, my brothers and sisters, are we holding on to the offenses of others? Ask yourself, if the Lord was holding our offenses against us, the word of God said, Lord, the psalmist, if you count our sins, our iniquities, Lord, who will survive? But the above all, he goes on to say, but with you, Lord, is what? Kindness. With you is forgiveness. With you is love. How many of us here are free from hatred? Is there someone who has wronged you that you have failed to forgive? Sometimes we imagine the pain. Yes, we cry when we remember the pain. Yes, it is true. But listen, when you look at it, you just see that it's not worth it to hold on to it. No. Imagine Jesus Christ, the Son of Mary, the Son of God. He went to the cross. And on the way, as they were beating him, punishing him with a crown of thorns, they stripped him naked. And they nailed him to the cross. But he said something. Who has the Bible? Yes. The Gospel of Luke, chapter number 23. Open it up, let us see. Get down to verse number 33. Luke 23. It's in the New Testament, the Gospel. Get down to verse number 23 and read out what Jesus said. In the midst of pain, in the midst of sorrow, in the midst of shame, in the midst of mockery, there was something he said. Who has it? Forgive. Yes. Read it. Did you hear that? Increase your volume. Increase the volume. Father, forgive them. He prayed to the Lord for forgiveness towards those who were persecuting him. When was the last time you prayed for your enemy, your sworn enemy, the one who has done you something that has made you not to sleep? There is someone that in the midst of your joy, once you remember him or her, everything is destroyed. If you are feeling so sleepy and you remember that person, sleep dies. The Lord is asking you today to speak that language of love, the language of forgiveness, the language of strength, the language of unity. I forgive you. That is what it means. I forgive you. Three words. I love you. I forgive you. Simple translation. But then, my brothers and sisters, there is the irony of life, which we do not understand. When you cherish evil, when you cherish hatred, when you cherish envy, when you are jealous, when you are unforgiven, you breed what? Every vice. The word of God says, perverse thoughts separate man from God. Is there someone who hates you that you always see that person? Even when you do not see that person, you are thinking and wishing evil. You are separating yourself from God. Who has the Bible? Wisdom chapter number 1. Let's read verse number 3. The book of Wisdom, chapter number 1. Let's see. The Lord admonishes us and reminds us that when we think we are God's children and there is unforgiveness in our hearts, when we begin to think evil for the other, God is not waiting until you act it out. Remember what the Lord said. If you look at your neighbor or you look at a woman with lustfulness in your heart, you have already committed it. When you not evil for your neighbor in your heart, you have already committed it. The only thing that is separating you and the action proper is what? Time and opportunity. Are you with me? Let the right opportunity come. You will see yourself in action. Who has it? Wisdom chapter number 1. By the read verse number 3. Anyone who has it? Yes. Yes. I'm happy. There is competition in reading the word of God. I want you, my brothers and sisters, to begin to touch the word of God. Okay? Even if you did not read it in the church, learn how to remove your Bible. Touch it. Bring it to the church. Even if we do not read it, just hold it. It is your weapon of war. Yes, who?
For perverse thoughts separate men from God.
Again.
For perverse thoughts separate men from God.
Perverse thoughts separates man from God.
And when his power is tested, it convicts the foolish.
When power is put to the test, it confounds the foolish, the wicked. Are you perverse in your thoughts? Are you perverse in your words? Are you perverse in your actions? When people cry and ask you for forgiveness, do you reach out to them? How often do we allow our ego to come in between ourselves and God, ourselves and our relationships with one another, ourselves and every good thing? You did this to me. Me, excuse me, who are you? Psalm 8, when you go down, it says, Lord, what is man that you care for him? Mortal man, that you keep him in mind. Take his breath, and he returns to clay. Psalm number 8. But above all, it says, from the lips of children, God will find praise, even when we fail to give him this praise. God is calling us to a newness of heart. Purge yourself of your sins, and you will see how much God's love, God's glory will shine on you. What is that giving you sleepless nights? What has that man done? What has that woman done? What has that child done? What has that neighbor of yours done that you cannot overlook? He gave us a perfect example on the cross. Father, forgive them. But in our pride, we fail to forgive others. Sometimes we say, I will show you what I can do. I will tell you who I am. And that is why we have a lot of problems now in our world. Anger, wrath. Ecclesiastes reminds us, he says, look, let me read it. The first reading of today. Man embraces what is evil. He says, Ben-Sirah, chapter number 27. We begin from verse number 30. He says, wrath and anger are hateful things, yet the sinner hugs them. The sinner does what? Hugs them. Are you filled with wrath and anger? Are you resentful? Do you not evil for others for because of what they have done? Have you failed to forgive? The Lord is asking you today for a change of heart. Has he approached you? Has she approached you and asked you for forgiveness? What is holding you down from reaching out? You know, in our lives as human persons, sometimes we destroy ourselves and think we are destroying God or our neighbor. God lives in that person you hate. Imagine what it looks like if God has refused to forgive you, to forgive each and every one of us. In his mercy, he still cares for us. We wrong him every minute of the day. And when we approach him at the confessional, we bear out our minds. With the fire of the Holy Spirit, he purifies us. He makes us new. And he tells us to go in the peace of Christ. But then when we step out, we fail to forgive others. God is calling us to a new life. The servant failed to forgive his fellow servant. Meanwhile, he had begged God for forgiveness, and God forgave. Are you ready to forgive? When you fail to forgive, let me tell you what you do. You are tying yourself round and making yourself handicapped. You are making yourself an agent to the devil. You are making yourself an agent. I don't even know what to use to qualify it. I'm looking for it. You dispose yourself to be used by the devil for wrong, for the worst. God is calling us today, my brothers and sisters, to rejuvenate that joy of Christ, the joy of the Lord. The prophet Nehemiah, chapter number 8, when you get down to verse number 10, he says, "The joy of the Lord shall be my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength." Do you think you cannot forgive? The joy of the Lord is in you, and let it be your strength. Look at what that person has done. Thrash it. That is what the thrash can is meant for. Thrash it. Free yourself, that you might do what? Think of goodness. And you might see the goodness in others, that you might prosper, that you might be happy and be fulfilled, so that the thoughts of others will not bring you sadness, but will bring you joy and fulfillment. And that's what the Lord is asking from you. Not for the Lord's own good, no, but for our individual good. When you forgive, you are not doing God a favor. I hope you know. Am I right? When we forgive, we are not doing God a favor. Do you understand? No, we are doing ourselves favors. In the sense that we free our hearts, we free ourselves. That the Spirit of God may abound in us and help us to be what? Productive. When I went through the first reading, the gospel, sorry, and Jesus was talking about the servant, let me tell you what came to my mind. Proverbs. Let somebody open up the book of Proverbs. You know, sometimes we think God doesn't exist and he doesn't know things. No, he does. And it is always out there for every one of us to see. Jesus gave them the parable, and it was a wonderful story. And I said, Old Testament, Jesus was going back to it and bringing it to fulfillment in the New Testament. Proverbs, chapter number 21, verse 13. Who has the Bible? Let's see. Proverbs, chapter number 21.
I've got one.
Yes, read it. Verse 13.
Oh, just a minute.
You got it? Yes.
If you close your ear.
Keep struggling. Read, all of you read.
If you close your ear to the cry of the poor, you will cry out and not be heard.
Increase your volume.
If you close your ear to the cry of the poor, you will cry out and not be heard.
If you close your ears to the cries of the poor, you will in turn cry and no one will hear you. Did you get that? Did you get that? Everybody's quiet. Did you get that?
Yes.
Are you guilty? Are you guilty? And your guilty is making you silent, right? The Lord is asking you for a change of heart. Sometimes we fail to listen to the cries of others, those who are asking us for forgiveness. Sometimes they have failed to come to us individually, but their actions towards us will always remind us, this person is seeking my face. Am I right? And at that point, that's when we want to show who we are. I said, you must beg me. Look, he's not begging you. She's not begging you. She is asking the God in you to wake up. Do you understand it? She's, who are you? But it is the God in you that makes you who you are. So when she or he is asking for your forgiveness, he or she is asking the love, the God in you to do what? To wake up. Because God is love. He says, whoever refuses to listen to the cry of the poor, of the weak, will in turn plead and not be heard. What an irony. Nobody wants that. We all want to pray, and we all want God to hear us. Look at the wonderful prayer Jesus taught us. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. I want you to understand, the day we will do, so Anna, I just pray, you know, things work out fine. When we have Bible studies, you come. We will discuss a whole lot of things we say here in the Mass that we do not know the meaning. Imagine the prayer Jesus taught us. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those. Not for we forgive those. No. No. Look at it very well. Forgive us our sins as we forgive. That means if I forgive less, forgive me less. I want you to understand it. Forgive us our sins. It means, Lord, follow my own pattern of forgiveness to forgive me. But many of us do not know. Are you with me? We do not know. But I want you to understand it now. Forgive us our sins, Lord, as we forgive others. That means, follow the pattern of our forgiveness to forgive us. And that means, if I am unforgiven, Lord, never relent. Do not forgive me. Wow. That is what we say every day at prayer. So when you look at that, and you know that you want to be forgiven by God, my brothers and sisters, be quick to forgive. So that you can go to bed and sleep. The word of God said, for the wicked man, he plots the defeat of goodness, even as he lies on his bed. You know, let me tell you something. There was this guy in Nigeria. He was working for my dad. So once, there's this game called draft. Do you know it? It's just like the, I don't know. But there's a game you play, you know. You stay on this side, the opponent stays on this side, you have 20 seats on each, and you play, who wins? And one day, we were talking, he plays this game very well. And I was asking him, man, how come you know this very well? Do you know what he said to me? I will never forget it in my life. He says, even when I'm sleeping, I am dreaming how I win, what I will do, and finish the game of my opponent. That even when he is asleep, that is what he's dreaming. That is what he's conjuring. That is what he's planning. The defeat of his opponent. Sometimes it is like that with us. When we fail to forgive, all our thoughts and words and deeds are centered at doing what? Defeating the one we have called our opponent, our enemy. When you fail to forgive, you put off the light of Christ in you. When you fail to forgive, you retain anger and sorrow within yourself. That's why sometimes you see some people, no matter what they eat, no matter the amount of wonderful things they eat, they will still remain like people who have never eaten in 1 year. As if others eat and clean their hands on their own body. You know, when you finish eating in your house, you go to his house or her house, clean your hand. You take your fork to his house and clean it around his mouth and probably on the lips. Because no matter what they eat, they are always thinking negative. The Lord has created us to be joyful, my brothers and sisters. And let that joy of the Lord radiate. Let it help us to reach out to other people. Otherwise, you know why? The measure you give will be the measure you will get. It takes nothing to forgive. It doesn't. It takes nothing to forgive, but it revives your joy and shows the other how wonderful, how matured, how Christian you are in your life when you forgive. The Lord is challenging you today. Bring that heart unto this altar of sacrifice. He will purify it and He will give you back goodness. Ezekiel 36. We begin from verse number 24. He says, I will remove the heart of stone from your hearts, and I will give you a heart of flesh instead. Are you ready to receive that heart of flesh? Do you want to read it? Ezekiel 36. Who has it? God makes us a very wonderful promise. When you go home, ask yourself, where? Ask the Lord, Lord, where is my heart of flesh? Why this heart of stone? Ask him for his removal, and he will do it. And he will restore your joy. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Rise and profess our faith. I believe in one God.
Father the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of God, one Father, all ages. God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father, through him all things are made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. And by the Holy Spirit, he was born of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, with the Father and the Son, as the Lord and glorified, who has spoken to the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I acknowledge the baptism of the forgiveness of sins. I look for the resurrection of the dead, life and life to come. Amen.
Let us in faith bring our needs to the Lord. Let us bring to the Lord those who think we hate and we have things against, and those who have things against us and we know. Let us present them and ourselves to the Lord, asking that in His mercy He may renew our hearts.
For the ongoing success of our Ignite campaign and for the continued generosity and prosperity of all the families here at Sacred Heart and across our Archdiocese, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For reconciliation among all who are baptized into Christ, for collaboration among all churches in sharing His message of forgiveness, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For peace and reconciliation among ancient enemies, especially in the Middle East, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For all those who have left the church, that they may find the grace to return and help build up the body of Christ here on earth, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For catechists and all who share the good news of God's reign, And for all who yearn to know our living God better, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For the safety of all the members of our armed forces and for their families and loved ones, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
All the prayers that we hold in the silence of our heart, all our intentions, spoken and unspoken, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
God, our Father, we come before you with thanksgiving in our hearts. We thank you for enabling us to hear your word. Help us to put it into practice. Bless, guide, direct, and answer, provide for all your children who, in their generosity, have decided to reach out to the poor. Bless the process they have brought. Bless those who will receive them. May the joy of the Lord continue to radiate through us. Almighty God, we have our needs. We bring them to you in faith, trusting that you will heal us and grant us what we ask you in faith. For we make these prayers to you through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Father has his basket for the children. My brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept
Amen. Look with favor on our supplications, O Lord, and in your kindness accept these, your servants' offerings, that what each has offered to the honor of your name may serve the salvation of all through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in you we live and move and have our being. And while in this body, we not only experience the daily effects of your care, but even now possess the pledge of life eternal. For having received the first fruits of the Spirit, through whom you raised up Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in the Paschal mystery. And so, with all the angels, we praise you. As in joyful celebration, we acclaim. Of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving you thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. Once more, giving thanks, he gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Daniel, our Archbishop, Charles, his auxiliary, and all the clergy, Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the Blessed Apostles and Saints, St. Paul, St. Maximilian Kolbe, St. Patrick, St. Sixtus, St. Cornelius, St. James, St. Anthony, St. Elizabeth, St. Cecilia, St. Martha, St. Joan of Arc, St. Anne de Beaupré, St. Josephine Bakita, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we remember it to be co-heirs to eternal life, may praise and glorify you through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. The Savior's command, and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom and the power and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, we say to you, our apostles, peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
May the peace and joy of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you always. Brothers and sisters, look up, behold him, behold forgiveness, behold love. Behold him who forgave us while we are still sinners, and he's asking us to forgive others. Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, he takes away the sins of the world. Happy are those of us called to this supper of the Lamb. Lord. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, bring us to eternal life.
Thank you.
the working of this heavenly gift, O Lord, we pray, take possession of our minds and bodies, so that its effects and not our own desires may always prevail in us, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
There will be a church brunch at Senior Bingo tomorrow, September the 17th, in the parish hall after the 9 a.m. Mass. Everyone is welcome for fellowship and brunch. Please support the Czech Festival. The Czech raffle tickets are on sale after Masses. The raffle tickets are $10 each. Please turn in your sold raffle tickets with money after Masses are in the church office. Sign-up sheets to help with the Czech Fest are in the narthex. Please volunteer some of your time. Everyone is needed and helpful. Czech Fest auction prizes may be dropped off in the church office from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. Monday through Friday. Thank you.
This evening we wish to bless our teachers who help our children in forming their faith, to help in teaching our children what we have that they may have. So I call the teachers to come forward if they are here. And if there are some kids here who are within, they can do a way through the catechism classes, can you come forward and support your teachers and receive the blessings too? Our God has called us to become missionaries to ourselves and to others. These people here have volunteered themselves to teach your children, our children, the faith. Am I right?
Yes.
Let us pray for them. Yes. Let us stop insulting them and embarrassing them. Yes. Because sometimes some parents go over there and insult them. Some tell them what the time is and when they should go. Well, but I know we are more than that. Am I right?
Yes.
And I know we will change. Am I right?
Yes.
And we shall make them happy. Am I right?
Yes.
Okay. For the pastoral activity of the church, the cooperation of a great many people is needed so that communities as well as individuals may advance to full maturity in faith and continually show forth their faith through the celebration of the liturgy, through study, and through their manner of life. This cooperation is provided by those like them who devote themselves to catechesis, enlightened by God's words and the teaching of the church. Catechists impart to others an initiation or a deeper formation in those realities that they themselves have learned as truth to be followed in living and to be celebrated in the liturgy. In this celebration, we will bless the name of the Lord for giving us such wonderful co-workers and pray that through the Holy Spirit, they will receive the grace they need in their service to the church. I now ask you, are you willing to exercise the ministry of catechism here in Sacred Heart Parish? Okay. May God help you to be good stewards to what has been entrusted to you. And may you and all the catechists who serve in this parish receive the grace you need for your service here at Sacred Heart. We implore God to bless you. With your heavenly and fatherly blessing, O Lord, strengthen these servants of yours in their resolve to dedicate themselves at catechism. Grant that they will strive to share with others what they themselves derive from pondering your word and studying the church's teachings. Let them gladly join those who teach in honoring and serving your name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Parents are good parents. You are all our guidance. You are all entrusted with a special role and responsibility in forming your children in faith. It is fitting for this catechetical Sunday that we offer a blessing for them. For all the parents who bring their children for the catechism classes, we pray for you, God our Father. Let your peace settle within the hearts of these mothers, fathers, and guidance. Give them strength and wisdom as they care for their children. Show them how to raise their families with patience and tenderness. Give them strength during the times of great difficulty and help them recognize the little joys they are part of each day. May they grow in wisdom, understanding, and grace. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Almighty God bless you all, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. And thank you for your commitment. Thank you very much. I know some people here are not jealous. Am I right? Yes. Some people are jealous. Father, pray over them and trust them. Don't worry, come and join them and become a catechist. And we'll pray for you too and bless you. Joan, Lizzie, bring those back. Just bring some of them back. You know, I want to say thank you to each and every one of you. Look at me, just look at me. Don't worry, don't look at them, look at me. And the one talking, they'll bring them back. I want to thank you for your generosity. You have responded immensely, not all, just bring at least two or three, so that they see that what I'm saying is the truth. Okay, bring up, bring up. The office is full. This is just for those who couldn't bring theirs in the office. They brought it while coming to church. Yes. You know? Yes. It's for you to see. And the Lord is generous, and he will be generous to you too. So if you have not thought of how to help our brothers and sisters who are suffering because of the flood this night, do something. But I must tell you, your generosity is moving mountains. Trust me. People come to the office every day looking for something, and they get. And the office is filled with bags. People have even brought what they were not asked to, but they have seen that these are essentials. It shows how magnanimous you are in your heart. And we pray that God, in his mercy, may bless and sanctify you. Bless your heart. Receive what you have brought for his people. May he reward you, strengthen you, and provide for you. May his power come down to rest upon you, as he accepts your sacrifice, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you very much, and God bless you. There is something we are thinking of, and I want you to be a part of it. I know you will say, you haven't finished. This is the last. Because of the activities of the 1st of October, our Czech Fest Day, I want to seek your opinion so that everybody participates and we have the full joy. That should be 2 weeks' time. I'm thinking of moving. The Saturday Mass will remain at 5 p.m. because many will come who will be serving on Sunday. Am I right?
Yes.
Then on Sunday, I'm thinking of moving the Mass, bringing the first one down to 8 a.m. The second one will be Spanish at 9:30. So that by 10:30, everybody should be at the ground and we'll start our enjoyment. Do you think that would be okay?
Yes.
Are you sure?
Yes.
So if I'm held anywhere, I will say we all agreed.
Yes.
Don't hold for agreement, hold Sacred Heart Catholic Church for me. Is that true?
Yes.
Okay, so spread the good news. On our church first day, the first mass will be at 8 a.m. Second mass, Spanish, at 9:30. And there will be no evening mass. Because by evening, everybody will be there, right?
Yes.
So I wouldn't want to be saying mass when everybody's enjoying it. Because my mind will not be here. The Lord be with you.
With your spirit.
May the Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Thanks be to God.
You have a wonderful night rest and a blessed coming week.
Thank you, Father.